Richard Perry and I met at a Phil Spector party for his wife's birthday. We had a chance to talk, and he told me he liked all my albums. I told him I liked Tiny Tim and what he did with him and all that, you know. So we became friends. We had a lot in common. We found out we were both from Brooklyn, and we both liked Laurel and Hardy and East Side Kids and Sherlock Holmes, you know, and Charlie Chan. Months went by, and I had in the back of my mind, geez, I'd like to do an album with him, you know. And then he later on called and said,
Harry, hi, Richard, would you like to do an album?
And so I said, sure. And so he did, and this is the beginning of it. Ain't there nothing I can take a set
after? Do believe this belly aches? Now let me get this straight. Put the lime in the coconut.
And of course, who can forget coconut? Harry and I came upon the great idea to introduce more than one character singing the song. Originally, it was just one vocal all the way through. The idea of making it even more of a cartoon and creating the personality of the doctor as a different voice and of the woman and all the different characters, which Harry's probably the only singer alive who could do something like that.
A lot of the rock and roll people are getting into films now. It seems like a logical progression. And this is our first attempt at it. And it's terrible, but it gets better sometimes. Put the lime in the coconut and call me in the morning. The camera's looking for me and he follows me up the stairs. Watch the cameraman's shadow here. There he is. What you learn about filmmaking is you do it, you know. Up there, almost into the ladies' room. Oh, wrong room. Turn left. He thinks I'm in the elevator. He doesn't know where I am. So he goes in the elevator. There he is. Hi, folks. How did they do it? So anyway, we arrived in London, but not on this bus. This bus was used for this old man and his friends. We got these people from two old choirs. We had an idea of doing this song, which you'll hear at the end of the movie. And it was a sensitive lyric, and I was rather embarrassed. Originally, we were going to make it a surprise. A bus, you just see a bus of the old people, and every other few minutes, we'd show you the bus, and then cut to something else, and the bus would be getting closer to the city, and then we'd surprise you at the end by seeing all these old people in the studio. But we're not going to do that now. I'm just going to show it to you, tell you exactly what's happening. They loved it. This is their day out, and you'll see what happens at the end. This song called At My Front Door, made famous by the Eldorados, whose only follow-up was At My Back Door. Crazy little mama, come on, knocking, come on, knocking at my front door, door, door. Crazy little mama, come on, knocking, come on, knocking at my front door, door. Crazy little mama, come on, knock, knock, knocking just like you did before. I woke up this morning with the feeling of despair, just looking for my baby, but she wasn't there. Heard someone knocking in my to my surprise. There stood my baby, looking in my eyes. Crazy little mama. So the idea was to like film what we were doing in London, you know? And we called it, Did Somebody Drop His Mouse? That's me. And that's Ray Cooper, he's a great percussionist. Now he's playing with Elton John. And there's Uncle Richard Perry, my dear old pal from Brooklyn. Klaus Borman. Ray Cooper. Peter Frampton, young at the time. Nicky Hopkins. Here's what you're saying.
Harry, could you, Harry, excuse me.
There's Ringo in the background, dear old Ringo. Dear friend, greatest drummer in the world. There's me playing Klaus. John Uribe, a blues player. And there's me playing John Uribe. Nicky Hopkins, cigarettes.
followed by Nicky Hopkins smoking one, and there's me doing Nicky Hopkins. There's Ringo. And that's me doing Ringo. I can't play drums, so I didn't use any. And that's me doing me. That's what an empty studio looks like when you're taking a break.
Here we are in the armpit of London, Soho District. One of the more fashionable districts of London. Quite a street.
And they called it PP Alley, because all the winos used to line up there. Every night we come down this alley and wonder what we're going to do next. We were intimidated by the cameras, you know. None of us had been in cameras much, in front of cameras much, except for like Ringo. And this is the studio we recorded at, Trident House. Great engineer named Robin Cable. And Richard's idea was to come here and get in the English sound, you know, the recording sound, Neve consoles, and a bit of drum sound.
And the session is beginning. As we go in the studio, and we're running down the song, What's Your Sign?
Baby, did you come here all? What's your sign?
That's me. It was a good outfit I had on that day, you know?
Let's try one with it, you know?
Richard's really good. He works well with the musicians. They like him. He's an over-perfectionist in certain areas, but he cares and he does his best. And he's a fine, fine producer. One of the top two in the world.
Okay. Rolling. There it is.
Hey, baby, you come here off. Watch your sign.
A lot of times you'll see lip-sync problems, you know, when the music doesn't match the mouth, you know. That's pretty close.
Of course, Harry and I are both Geminis, so it all makes sense now.
Back up in the control booth when after a playback, the one we left earlier and left the studio empty. And it's like, you know that part. I think we should drop like this.
I don't know. Because I'm Ringo saying, if you open your hands and you push,
and then slap the top of your wrist. Pop, pop, pop. That means clap hands and push away. There's always a few people hanging around the control room, you know. Which is good, because it gives you an audience to bounce off, you know. See Richard like that?
Yeah, a nice one.
They're expecting me to score. Have you heard it all before? And what's more?
Hey. So it's very intimidating with the cameraman there. We just, all the lights have to be on, you know, and it's not a normal recording environment. Normally, you get drunk and relax and get to know each other and the song and just familiarize yourself with each other and the tune until you finally get comfortable with it and play it right. But it's difficult when there's a camera crew recording everything you're doing. You can see it on the faces of people. They don't really like it, neither did we. But we figured we'd do it, so we're doing it, you know. Upstairs talking about what we just did.
When it rocks, it sure
does. It does. It sure does.
See, nobody knows what's going on. When it rocks, it sure does. It sure.
I'll tell you, it was from the second verse out, I think it was pretty good, except for that one little bloop that you made.
Which
one?
Oh, there were
plenty
of little clams, but you get two in fact?
Well, it's the general feel. Harry, don't smoke those.
Come on, Mom. I stayed home yesterday, you know.
I got a menthol for you.
Yeah. You can't smoke them in
Because I've got a grape throat.
No, not a menthol.
Have you been smoking more now and enjoying it less?
For sure.
Switch from Hots to St. Moritz.
I don't like smoking through
it. Yeah, but I don't like cameras. It gets easier after a while, you know, you get used to the camera. But at the beginning, I was very nervous. Richie was, and you could see it. Look at those eyes, you know. There's nerves and a hangover.
Well, you're dead a long time, aren't you? Just as well be happy.
Do you always sit at the back of the coach?
Nearly always. Noisy lot.
She always sits in the back seat of the
I don't know who these people are. It's like a Martian.
Good old spaceman.
So happens Elton John had Rocket Man at the same time. Didn't know about that. You can notice on this track the brilliant drumming of Ringo. He's like, when there was a hesitation, he just bust his way through. You know, he's like thunder, you know, strong and straight. He and Jim Kelvin play together. It's like they call themselves Thunder and Lightning, you know. The two best drummers playing together in the history of the world.
We originally wanted to suspend Harry over the orchestra with invisible wires as a visual to this song.
This spot here, I don't know what we're going to do with it. We're going to have pictures of the Earth. You know, spaceman joke. And right now I'm looking at a blank screen as I narrate this. Maybe we'll just leave this blank screen and so you can hear me talking. You know. It's a nice screen. And we couldn't get the shots from NASA and we ran out of budget and all that stuff. In fact, the reason we're doing this narration is because we didn't think the film made it, so we thought we'd liven it up by talking to you. Gives you a chance to rest your eyes, doesn't it?
Go on. You know, there's like several good takes, and it's the kind of thing where if there's a great second verse, it can be used as the first verse.
It's Uncle Richard.
Yeah.
Harry, don't smoke so much.
How about some tea?
Oh. I'd prefer a sandwich.
And how about a little tea?
Yeah, coffee.
This is what really happens in making an album, folks. Want some tea?
There's the tea boy of the month.
In England, it's really nice, you know.
Sandwich?
Yes, I just said so. Got one?
Don't mind if I do.
Thank you. They have a guy called a tea boy at Trident Studios. He does nothing but serve you tea and help you out to make it a little easier for you. And it helps, too, you know, you get... it's like, you know, somebody's trying to make it easier for you, and that always makes it better.
I think we peaked in take 49.
Was that the one we heard about
really...
2 hours back?
No, that was the one. That was the last one we heard.
This is called the lottery song, and that's the real Richard right there. And I was just introducing the song to the players so they could hear it for the first time to get an idea of how to do it. We ended up doing it with guitars.
You can take the laundry, I'll come by on Monday. You give me your money, I will buy a ticket. On the local lottery,
so they're aware of two things now. One is listening to the song, the other one is the camera. And I'm aware of two things too. Trying to remember the song, which wasn't quite finished, and the camera, and also the fact that the band is just looking at me, you know? Bella Dama.
Wait till summer,
We could buy a trailer. We could go to Vegas. We could buy a trailer.
That's me and Ken Scott, the engineer. While he's doing that, Ken and I are working out the sounds up in the control room. And this, folks, is how a record is made.
Or we could make a record, sell a lot of copies. We could play Las Vegas and be very happy.
I think I had written this song about a day before, and I was still, you know, figuring it out. This guy's name's Tom. He's great. He has a wooden leg that squeaks. This particular song, I remember, we decided to do it with just Nicky Hopkins, the piano player, and myself. He's a great piano player, and he's trying to accompany me, and I'm not used to, like, being accompanied. So he can hear us both waiting for each other, you know. Nice pair of eyes. About recording together, you get to be friends real fast, you know, and we've maintained all our friendships and have stayed together for we've done like 4 albums since this one, you know, and we've become sort of like a band in a way, you know. I've never been in a band, but this is the closest thing to it. And you really learn to love everybody, you know. It's the safest place in the world to be is in a studio, because it's all good vibes, something to do, and it's all pleasant. It's just singing and music and listening and create something, you know. Everybody does their best. Sometimes it comes out not as well as you'd like, you know. But this came out pretty good. Shy human being, and he's very talented. He's seen a lot more beauty than most people have on earth, and he's very into what he does. He's very shy and retiring. I'm more of an extrovert, you know, when I'm with my friends, but in public situations I get scared, because I think that won't match up with the real me, and I'm always afraid that I'm not being me, you know. These people don't worry anymore. They've got little left to lose. And they know it, and that's what makes them smile all the time. You know, you'll see later on when they're singing the song, it's a sad one. She was a little scared. See this or hear this, I think of those people and what they remembered and what I remember. I remember very little of the album, but there's certain moments you keep with you, you know. See him look to me, and I was waiting for him. He was sharp, very anticipated. Last man you'll see in the sequence, Tom, his name was, with the wooden leg. At the end of our sessions, he said, "It was really a pleasure. I'd like to come back." And Richard Perry says,
"Oh, well, you're welcome to join us on the next album, Tom, if you'd like."
He said, "Okay, if I'm alive."
Hell of a sweet old man.
He was 84, or just about to have his 85th birthday at the time. A couple of heads. I like that shot. I'm alive. And this is showing the boys a new song called You're Breaking My Heart.
Breaking my heart, you're tearing it apart. Fuck you. All we wanna do is have a good time. Now I'm blue.
Then we thought we'd do some funny costume things for the camera. So we all, well, four of us, Jim Price, Bobby Keys, Klaus Voorman, and myself, dressed up like 50s rock and rollers and drank a few bottles of brandy. And went and filmed ourselves trying to be an act. And this is like the real basic track of the song.
You're breaking my heart, you're tearing it apart.
We spent about 6 hours trying to learn this little dance step, which we never got right. You know, the studio was too small. Poor cameraman had a camera on his shoulder for 6 hours. At the end, he blew his top. He says, I've had enough of this, you know.
Can we do one more?
And because we kept saying one more 90 times, you know. And Bobby Keys said, we had a little argument with the film people versus the music people. Bobby Keys says, you know, hey, Mr. Kodak, man, why don't you take that brownie and shove it up your ass? This Bobby over there. He looks like he belongs to the stage. Look at him. He's got that that rock and roll stance, you know, the saxophone. He's played with every great musician in the world. And this is partner Jim Price at the time. Jim Price has gone on since this to produce records for like Joe Cocker and the likes. And both Jim and Bobby played with the Stones for a while. A couple of years, I think. I didn't have a saxophone, so I borrowed Bobby Keys' sax strap and put it on the microphone to make it look like a sax, you know, so we had a section going. And you see the cigarette? Well, you missed it, but there was like a cigarette sticking out there. That's what they always do, you know. They always stick a cigarette in the end of the guitar and the sax thing. We thought it was funny at the time. This is working out our choreography. And it's also four bottles later. Now, Bobby, if you lay down right over there. Okay.
You're breaking my heart. You're tearing it apart, so fuck you.
There was a little controversy over the lyrics at first, you know, but that was then, you know. Record company executives and rack jobbers resent certain things like this. Even though it's common humor, sometimes they don't get the joke, you know.
Yeah, a lot of stations around the country used to play this a lot. I'm making their own edits. Probably could have been a big hit.
And Bobby and Jimmy being on stage a lot of, in fact, Klaus used to be with Manfred Mann before he was with playing with the Beatles and doing all that stuff. And so they've all been on stage. I'm the only one who hasn't. And Bobby's the guy who's supposed to know all the steps, so he showed us what to do. But you can see a lot of times he's not sure himself. You know, he's hoping that we'll remember what he said originally. That's what they did in the 50s, folks.
Kill them, Harry.
It's hard to stand up when you're loaded. See what I mean? You see, while we were doing things like this, we were also recording the album, you know? Like, one night we'd take off and do this, and then go to the studio and record all night long, and have hangovers the next day. There's a lot goes into making an album. It takes months and months and months, and a lot of work and follow-up, you know? And I guess by filming it, you know, you have a documentary, roughly, of what you've done, you know. And I don't know who's really interested. I'm interested in it. I like to see it. You know, people show me things like this. I'm always interested because you're looking to see what they're really doing, you know. And that's what we're really doing.
Sweet Schmilsson, starring One Night Only. Look at him, folks. Next stop, Radio City Music Hall.
I don't think we'd make it as an act.
That was a hot moment from Klaus.
There it is, the dying fly saxophone player. He gets up gracefully, though.
This is probably the closest Harry's come to performing live.
And that's that.
As we ride along the highway, listening to it's one of Harry and my favorite tracks we've done together. The inimitable classic, Let the Good Times Roll. This is one of those tracks we decided to do in the studio right at the spur of the moment. Often those turn out to be the best tracks. I think also in its own way, one of Harry's greatest vocals. He created a very unusual sound with the blend of harmonies he put on this tune. Listen. Now, we needed a solo in this section, so just before we were getting ready to mix it, there was this old 50-cent harmonica laying around the studio. Harry just picked it up and started playing it. In fact, I think it marks his harmonica debut on records. And this is the result.
And that's me playing harmonica. I've never played one before, and we found this little toy in the studio, so we just said, why don't you try to go ahead and play it. Oh, Harry, so I tried, and this is it. Not bad.
We are coming home indeed. The crowd on the bus is starting to get excited as they see destination in sight. Looks like we're cruising up Dean Street, coming to Water Street.
So before these people got there, we decorated the studio, you know, with balloons and made it look like heaven, and gave them all some sherry, and they didn't know quite what they were in for, but they were ready, because it was like a holiday for them. It was a day out of, day on the town, you know. And this is the people arriving finally at the studio. And they know they're there to do a session. This guy's great, old Tom. He has a wooden leg, by the way. And during one of the takes that you'll see in a couple of minutes, Klaus Voorman was in the control room, plugged directly into the console. And there's a lot of people downstairs playing, you know, and he said, it sounds like there's someone with a squeaky wooden leg. And no one could believe it, but then we went downstairs and we just asked, you know, politely if anyone had a squeaky wooden leg. And old Tom there said, yes, I do. It's funny, old people, you know, you give them like a little glass of sherry and they get loaded immediately. So as soon as they get in the studio and had a drink, they were ready to go. And just now they're walking down that alley I was telling you about. Meanwhile, I was nervous about whether or not they had read the lyrics of the song you're about to hear. And Richard and I started to feel a little guilty about it. We didn't know how they'd take it. So to cheer me up, he brought me next door and got me a suit. He said,
Harry, don't you think it'll be apropos if we with a little dignity for these people?
So while they were going inside, we went next door to a store and bought the suit and to show a little respect, you know. It was a very nervous day for me.
Oh, Welsh Wales.
Originally, we were going to do this song with little kids. Richard said, you know, we could have little kids doing the background. I said, well, why don't we use old people, you know, since it's about dying and getting old and... So if it wasn't offensive to them, I made sure that they had copies of the lyrics sent to them before they consented to do it. As it turns out, the guy forgot to give it to them, so they didn't know what they were going to do when they got here, you know. And I had to explain it to them, which was very embarrassing. But they all liked it. In fact, one of them said,
Oh, wait, now you ought to know about that one, eh?
Help with the seats.
This is their first look at the studio. And we hired a little quintet called the Henry Crine Quintet. There's a couple of organs and a bass and a guitar. You'll see them in a minute. And we dressed them up. That's Henry Crine, little hunchback man there. And this is his band.
One of London's hottest wedding and bar mitzvah bands.
And this is after one glass of sherry. So you get right into it, you know, really great. So they're not afraid. That's the nice part. We were afraid of what, you know? They're not afraid.
And there's our first lieutenant, David Katz, keeper of the schnapps.
What's interesting, you know, is to see what happens. Like, these people, when they were young, they weren't into movies, you know what I mean? They're still used to still photographs.
And anybody want whiskey, you're welcome. Why didn't you say, right, I've got whiskey?
The cameraman lined them up for like a little group shot, and they just stood perfectly still as though they were posing for a photograph rather than a movie. And these are the three. Watch how they pose. Hold it. Still holding.
The second from left had a thing for Harry.
Oh, no, don't. He's a nice boy. You pick it there, don't you?
Don't move.
What's he waiting for, Christmas?
And here he is, the star of the show, in his brand new suit.
Scared to death.
Yeah, I don't think we'll ever see another session that even comes close to resembling this as long as we work in the studio. And neither one of us wanted to hurt their feelings or intimidate them in any way by having them sing I'd Rather Be Dead Than Wet My Bed. Nevertheless, here we were, and we weren't really sure how they would react to it.
Maybe, is the air conditioning on?
What?
At this point, I would say that the old folks were gone. Stone drunk and ready to do anything. And now for the first time, they hear the song.
Oh, I'd rather be dead. I'd rather be dead. I'd rather be dead than wet my bed. I'd rather be dead. I'd rather be dead. I said dead than wet my bed.
She gets it.
Where you haven't got a care. Oh, you're better off there. Although it doesn't seem fair.
Wanna get it out?
I'd rather be dead. Oh, I'd rather be dead. Oh, I'd rather be dead than wet my bed. Oh, I'd rather be dead.
I'd rather be dead.
the big dead, and when he takes my hand on the very last day, I will understand, because better that way. Oh, I'd rather be alive, but when the dream comes true, you're better off dead. It could happen to you.
Folks, they loved every minute of it.
Beautiful world in the world. See, the song really should have started here. But Richie wanted an extra verse in it.
I think I'll take it to commercial.
Yeah. So I wrote an extra verse for it and we put it in.
Mountains when you're mad, your rivers when you're sad, and those deep blue seas. I love you.
Doesn't it kind of just make your heart melt?
All right, Richard. That's how you make an apple.